Hello and welcome to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. Our co-host today is Joan Wilshire. And she's going to come on in a minute and tell us who she's talking to. Today I'm talking to Gaelynn Lea, though, from Duluth, Minnesota. She's a great advocate and a real entertainer, and you'll see that in the interview. Joan, who's your guest today?
A fantastic guest today, Kristin White, the Executive Director of the Connected and Automated Vehicle Division of the Minnesota Department of Transportation.
And you've known her in years gone by.
I have. She's a great friend and colleague, and she's going to talk all about autonomous vehicles because they're going to be coming down a road near you in Minnesota.
Very good, and we're glad to have you here today. All that and more coming up next on Disability Viewpoint. Stay tuned.
You know, the era of automated and connected vehicles isn't way off in the future. It's actually happening right now.
The state of Minnesota is really excited about this autonomous shuttle project.
This is going to be huge on so many levels. The whole goal for people with disabilities is being able to live, work, and play in the community of their choice. People will be able to just get up one morning and decide where they want to go and go. Just do it.
I thought that it was a very smooth ride. It was nice. When you look at it, it's running smooth. It's good.
Overall, we've seen a lot of enthusiasm about the technology coming. This is kind of the preliminary phases to get the public involved and get our stakeholders engaged and really move this technology forward here in Minnesota.
Well, it's coming, and they're coming fast and furious. Yes, it's autonomous vehicles. They're coming to Minnesota. They're going to be such a huge impact for people with disabilities being able to live, work, and play, and just will be able to jump in one of those autonomous vehicles and get there independently. It's going to be fantastic. And pizzas can be delivered by those and other goods and services as well. So it's going to be huge. So with me today to talk about this new and up-and-coming trendy transportation device is Kristin White, Executive Director of CAV. That's the Connected and Automated Vehicle Division in MNDOT, the Department of Transportation in Minnesota. It's a long title and everything there, but welcome, Kristin.
Thank you for having me, Joan, and to all the viewers today. I'm so thrilled to be here.
First off, what is an autonomous vehicle, the self-driving vehicle?
An autonomous vehicle is one where at least one or more pieces of the human driving task are automated. So for those of us that have ever been in a vehicle or a plane that had cruise control, you are technically in an automated vehicle. But really, when we hear the word autonomous, we're thinking about the future. We're thinking about vehicles that have no human operator and can be driven remotely and autonomously with machines, artificial intelligence, and really, really powerful computers. Now, some of these vehicles are being tested in regions like California, Arizona, and even Nevada with their warm weather climate. But as you can imagine, it's really hard for a technology that's not driven by a human operator to operate in all kinds of weather climates. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be a long time until these autonomous technologies can come to Minnesota, unless we together work with industry, researchers, and communities to see how we can bring that technology safely to Minnesota now.
It's amazing, and you're right. I think the majority of us don't even realize we're driving features in our cars that are similar to a self-driving car. Is there any way we should be describing and talking about these vehicles to use the word autonomous versus self-driving? Are they both the same?
We actually just finished a year-long study just in the past few months where we interviewed over 2,000 Minnesotans to ask that question. How do you want us to talk about connected and automated vehicles? Because for most of us, if you open up CNN or Fox News, you see the term self-driving, but they're using that term to describe all the vehicles that we see on the roads today, including vehicles that have automated features, mm-hmm. but still are too dangerous for us to release any sort of power and not operate the wheel. And so there's a couple of key terminologies. The Society of Automotive Engineers is the international global panel of experts who actually design these technologies. And they've actually created 6 levels of automation for us to use to kind of use as a common vernacular or dictionary, if you will, to describe mm-hmm. this. And what they've done is they, out of these 6 levels of automation, level 0 is, of course, something with no autonomy, maybe a traditional car or collector car.
Sure.
All the way up to level 2 technology, which might have a few features like blind spot assist, or lane keeping assist. But these are all level 0, 1, 2 automations. They're automated vehicles that assist the drivers. It means there has to be a driver in the vehicle. Mm-hmm. When you look at levels 3, 4, and 5, these are the highest levels of automation. These are actually autonomous vehicles, which means that at certain points, the driver can relinquish control. And in some vehicles of the future, you can take your hands off the wheel and take your feet off the pedals if you have that ability and allow the car to drive itself. So there's a difference between those lower levels of automation and these higher levels of autonomy. But the words sound really familiar. So media journalists, even some of my own fellow experts in other regions get the language confused, which makes it confusing for all of us.
Wow. Well, why don't we get into talking about, you know, in 2019, the governor created the actual group, the committee. So why don't you talk about what the committee does, and then also about the new formation of the alliance, the statewide group.
So this work actually goes back to about 4 years ago in 2017, when our state leadership, including representatives from the governor's office, went down to Florida at a transportation summit. And lo and behold, one of these autonomous shuttles was going and rolling around the arena. And they thought, well, that's interesting for a warm weather climate like Florida, but how do we make sure that Minnesotans can benefit from these technologies in a safe way? And so in 2018, then Governor Dayton issued an executive order demanding that Minnesota plan and prepare for these technologies. And it did a few things. It established our office, the Office of Connected and Automated Vehicles. Right. It established the Governor's Advisory Council on Connected and Automated Vehicles, which Joan is an honorary member and was a member for many years. And it also established a few other bodies, including the interagency team for CAD. Okay. Now, this is a unique group that brings all levels of government together so that if there's policy we need to discuss, we can do that in one forum for us all to share ideas. What's really exciting about our Governor's Advisory Council is we try to have the 15 appointees that the governor appoints representing all levels of industry, community, government, including some really fantastic mobility advocates and representatives from the Council on Disability and from Mobility Mania, which is led out of Grand Rapids, Minnesota by Myrna Peterson. So this council has now been established for 3+ years. Each year they have an annual report where they outline their vision and goals. And their vision is really to find a way to harness connected and automated vehicle technologies to build a transportation system that is safe, accessible, equitable, healthy, and sustainable. And they do that in a few key areas. First is through innovation, through finding new research ideas and new partnerships. Two is through collaboration, so conversations like we're having today to share information and hear from you. Third is partnerships, working with private industry and with researchers so that they can hear directly from Minnesotans, including people who are watching right now to understand what they need to know to make their vehicles more accessible and more equitable. And last and most important, our program is foundationally principled on the fact of meaningful engagement. So reaching out to all community members across Minnesota, people in different rural areas with different incomes, with different abilities, even the tribes, to ask, what do you need our state office and program to do to meet your transportation needs?
So how are you and your group going to be really talking to people with disabilities about this important means of transportation that's coming soon?
We did a two-step process. So in 2018 through 19, we worked with a key set of stakeholders in 10 key policy areas. And Joan, actually, you helped us lead some of the accessibility work. And we heard from a very, very small group to help us understand where are some of the key areas we need to focus on and who are the stakeholders we need to start reaching out to so we can slowly build out that broad base of membership. So in the last year, what we're doing, which should culminate in August of this year, is a statewide messaging and engagement plan. And so this is using all the work and expertise that Joan and the Advisory Council has, as well as the survey feedback from over 2,500 Minnesotans from all the way from Duluth to Baudette, all the way down to La Crosse, to hear where should we be engaging you, how should we be working with you, and in what avenues do you want to participate? So they gave us ideas such as, why don't you come down to my community meeting down in Mankato, and we'd like to talk to you about what Mankato community members want from autonomous technologies. Some people suggested, why don't you come to the state fair and host a demonstration so I can see the technology? Other folks have said, why don't you come to different independent living centers and work with the different residents and the people who work in those centers to understand how we should actually inform the work that the state's going to be working on moving forward. So the plan should be finished later this summer, and then comes the hard part of implementing it. But that's the most fun part, I think, for our staff and team.
Right. Well, I don't think that'll be a problem for you, Kristin. That will be the least of your problems. So, you know, the autonomous vehicle is going to open up so many avenues for different pieces of the economy. Employment is going to be huge for people with disabilities and for everyone, quite frankly, because you'll be able to work and go to places that you might not be able to before. So working with the Department of Employment and Economic Development, housing, you'll be able to live in places that before you might not because transportation wasn't good to the job that you wanted to. And commerce. How we're going to be selling goods with those little robots with autonomous vehicle features, delivering the pizza and your groceries. And so how is the cab division going after all of those entities and working with them?
That's a great question, Joan. And you're absolutely right. The fascinating thing about connected and automated vehicle technologies is they don't just impact the future of transportation. They impact all the areas you just mentioned, economic development, access to jobs, access to education, healthcare, finding ways to even meet your own expectations of how you meet with community members and family members and going to public events and community events.
Right.
So one thing we're trying to do is understand the systems approach to this, which means just the Department of Transportation alone cannot do this work. So a few things that we're working on right now is understanding how can we work through this interagency CAB team, which represents all cabinet level agencies at the state, everything from agriculture to commerce,
right,
to the Department of Public Safety, to our human services, our board on aging, our council on disability, and many, many others, as well as mm-hmm. different levels of government, including the tribes, local communities, including cities and governments, and even our planning organizations across the state. And one of the fundamental challenges we face right now is that not enough Minnesotans are familiar enough with self-driving technology and the difference between automation and autonomy to help understand why it's so important to pass a state law to authorize the use of autonomous technologies in a safe manner on our public roads. So 2 years ago, the ICAF team sponsored a bill in support and in coordination with the Governor's Advisory Council that would have authorized, like 37 other states, the ability to test these technologies on public roads. And unfortunately, even though the council, the ICAB stakeholders, all levels of government, and the stakeholders that we work with on a daily basis supported this policy, and even though the policy had a specific requirement to work with communities with different abilities to bring them into these pilots and testing phases, unfortunately, the legislature didn't see a priority at the time.
Right.
And well, the major reason, Joan, that we talked about as it was in front of the committees was they're still afraid of the technology and don't understand all the different safety, rigorous requirements we have to go through at the state and federal level.
Right, it's
sure
a lot.
The technologies are safe.
Now, before we run out of time here, I want to make sure you talk quickly about your project down in Rochester.
Yes, so Rochester is always an innovation center, and we want you to join us over the next year for the Rochester Autonomous Shuttle, and we're even coming up with a cool and innovative name, and if any of you have ideas, we'd love to hear from you. So starting in August of 2021, we are going to be launching two autonomous shuttles in downtown Rochester, right in the core area, right in and around the Mayo Clinic campus.
Great.
And so these shuttles are going to be running to not supplement transit operations, but to understand how the community would like to use autonomous technologies in the future. We're going to understand how these work and test in a very busy, mixed environment in an urban area. And we're also going to test how they work in winter weather environments. So again, we hope with COVID, we will be able to start in August of 2021, but we're happy to share
wow.
more information at MNDOT.gov/automated. And we would love to bring any members of Disability Voices or listeners in today to, over the next year, come down.
We will be there. Absolutely. Now, before we go, what's a phone number or website that people can connect with you and learn more about autonomous vehicles coming to Minnesota?
MNDOT.gov/automated. We are so excited to hear from you. There are many ways to get involved. You can sign up for our newsletter or ask for how you can get involved in the Rochester project.
Great. Well, this has been fantastic. I think you and I could talk about this for hours. And so we just got a short snippet here of what's happening and coming to a road near you in Minnesota. So we are thrilled. So thanks again for being on the show with me today. And we'll keep having you back, and maybe we'll actually go on a ride with you in that autonomous vehicle.
Next time we'll be on the road show. Thank you so much, Joan, for your time, and I'm so thrilled to be here today.
Great.
When two souls meet and the whole world feels new, shared moments sweet, all colors bright and true, and there is laughter, and there are good things growing everywhere. And I'm happy to be in this place with you, and I'm happy to be in this place.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. My guest today is Gaelynn Lea, and she's from Duluth, Minnesota. And welcome to the show, Gaelynn.
Yeah, thanks so much for having
me. Thank you. And you were, you're pretty active in advocacy work there in Duluth. Can you tell me a little bit about that, or give me a little bit about your background first, and then
how you got into advocacy? I'm a musician and a public speaker, and I play violin. And so in 2016, I won the NPR Music Tiny Desk Contest, which is a national contest. So I was able to start touring, because of that, I got some press. And on my tours, I started getting asked to do some speaking about disability awareness and disability rights, and especially accessibility in the arts. And so I speak all over the country, but I also like to make sure that I'm working on activism here. So during coronavirus, I was pretty active in the mask mandate in Duluth, and working on arts accessibility funding right now for the state of Minnesota. So kind of try to make sure if it's relating to disability that I at least pay attention and try to do my part.
When you got into the mask mandate, which is pretty important these days, how did you feel that it was best marketed? What did you do to market it?
Well, what I was disturbed by is the fact that people with intellectual disabilities, especially living in group homes, were the most likely to die of COVID as any other group
right.
in America.
Right.
And so I think we just weren't talking about it enough. So in the letters that I wrote, I feel like it's a human rights issue rather than just a personal choice political decision. And so I made sure that view of this is a human rights. If we care about the people in our society, right. we have to care about a mask mandate.
Well, tell me a little more about your music and your advocacy things that you've done. What do you think has been the most effective for your advocacy?
Well, I love performing. It's just a really fun way to connect with other people and see the world and travel. And so that part is, I play kind of an electronic folk music. I use a looping pedal and I perform on my violin and sing. And so that's been cool just to kind of express myself. But the advocacy part, what has been most effective as a disability rights advocate is talking about accessibility in the arts. You know, a lot of venues
right.
are not accessible to people with disabilities. And so a couple of years ago, I made a decision not to play at inaccessible venues anymore. And so that limits where I can play by a lot, but if I'm very upfront about it and respectful but still firm in my boundaries of what I will and will not do, it's been able to start a lot of discussions around accessibility. Some venues have even built ramps and stuff to the stage so that I can get on their stage because I don't let them lift my wheelchair up anymore.
It's called honesty.
Yeah, yep. Yeah. That's another word
what,
for it.
When did you feel your career really pivoted from just playing at local venues to really branching out? When did you realize that my career has taken a big monumental step as far
yeah.
as your music?
Yeah, in 2016, I won that NPR Music's Tiny Desk Contest, and there were 6,000 people from all over the country that entered, so it was a pretty big win. And so that is what really turned my career. My husband and I, for the prize of that contest, got to do 4 shows all over the country with NPR Music, and by the end of that, we were like, well, if we're going to tour, this would be the time to try it, right? So we decided... we sold our house and bought a van and quit our jobs and then started traveling everywhere. And that was the big turning point for sure.
Great. What is your most memorable moment?
Well, it's hard to say. There's a lot of memorable moments when you travel. A few of them are, you know, I did a show in San Francisco and a lot of people from the disability rights community came out. It was a pretty diverse audience, and I have a song about disability rights called I Wait, and I sang that song, and after the show, it was just so cool to hear people say, you know, I hadn't seen a disabled artist performing on stage before, and now I have, and it meant a lot to them, and that was cool, because I think we need to see more representation. But I have a lot of other fun shows, like I got to open for Wilco and the Decemberists, and I was played in Ireland with my old Irish fiddle tunes, and there's just a lot of great memories from being on the road, for sure.
What was the most memorable moment of your advocacy? And when, and also, on the other side, what didn't work as far as your advocacy if you had to do all over again? What would you do differently?
That's good questions. One of my favorite moments of advocacy was I spoke at a conference out in Buffalo, New York, and they took me out to see the Disability History Museum, which is a pretty powerful exhibit in upstate New York that kind of talks about the history of not just disability rights, but the discrimination and separation that people with disabilities face. And at my show later for the conference, I got to meet 2 people who had actually lived in those institutions where they would just keep people with disabilities in like caged cribs. It was terrible, like really huge human rights abuses. But they had, obviously, as the world changed, they were put into different living situations, and they fell in love and got married, and these people were, like, in their 70s or 80s, and they just had, it was just so cool to meet people who had gone through such a terrible experience and come out the other side and, like, you know, joyful, and it was just, it was good for me to see that history, because I think we forget how far disability rights has come sometimes, because it is frustrating to feel like change isn't happening fast enough. But,
right.
You know, it was so bad even just like 100 years ago, even 40 years ago. People with disabilities did not have equal rights, and they certainly weren't treated, you know, as equal. So it's good for me to remember that. So
We were always kind of in a box.
Yep.
If you took off tomorrow and went to Washington, went to Washington, D.C., how do you think your advocacy or your music could be effective out there?
You know, I think there's a lot of people working for disability rights, so I don't know if I would. I would advocate specifically for accessibility in the arts, just because that's the area that I'm most familiar with. The thing that I want to see, though, in Washington is I'd like to see an initiative to help disabled people run for office, because I think things legislatively aren't going to change unless people with disabilities are helping to actually write those laws.
Yeah, you got
to
speak up.
See that.
Yeah, the thing about inclusion. And if somebody wanted to do what you do today but hasn't done it yet, music or advocacy, what would you recommend they do? How would they start?
I would recommend just starting in your own community, you know, like write your city councilors, go to an open mic and play. You know, I started at open mics, you know, I didn't start touring. You have to start somewhere.
Yeah.
And even with my advocacy, the very first speaking engagement I did was at our Health and Human Services Conference in Duluth.
Right.
So you have to start where you are, right? And that's just do it and do it a lot.
Absolutely. Now that we get to the final word segment of the show, is there anything I didn't cover or we didn't say that you want to cover before we sign off?
Yeah, I think that in my lifetime, I would love to see disability viewed as, instead of an impairment or something to be feared or pitied, as a form of diversity because it's totally natural. We've disabled people have been here since the beginning of the human race, and we're going to be here forever. So just viewing it as a form of diversity that we can celebrate, that's what I'd like to see.
Absolutely. You live in the city of Duluth. So if you lived in the city of Duluth and they approach you to create a PSA, what do you think the most important one up there would be? What would you produce first?
I think right now the one that I would focus on is keeping your sidewalks clear.
Yeah, absolutely.
Snow in the winter and then things like garbage bins in the summer. Just how important pedestrian like pathways are, and it can't just be this big. It's got to be big enough for a person in a wheelchair to use, right?
Right.
And how that's all of our responsibilities.
Any final word that I didn't cover that you want to say before we go?
How
can we get your music and where can we see it perform?
Oh yeah, that's a great thing. So I have a website. It's violinscratches.com.
Do that one more time. Do it again.
Yep, violinscratches.com.
Okay.
And I have a YouTube show. When the quarantine started back in March 2020, I started doing a weekly show every Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, and I'm still going to be doing it through the year. I have a different special guest artist every week, and this week is a disability rights advocate named Ruth Patterson, but every week is a totally different kind of artist, and it's really fun. So I have a YouTube channel under the name of Gaelynn Lea, and every Sunday at 2, you can join me for some music and conversation.
Well, it sounds great. It was an honor to have you on this show. We hope you come back and see us again.
I will for sure. I'll be publishing a book in 2022, so I will definitely reach out to
you. Do you have a name for that?
No, not yet. I'm working on it. Thank you so much.
Very good. Gaelynn Lea from Duluth, please pick up her music and watch her YouTube channel, and more importantly, watch her advocacy work. It's a very important thing. Thanks for being on the show, Gaelynn. We hope to have you on again.
Yay, thank you so much. Take care.
If only love would be our guide,
That's our show for today on Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. I want to thank Joan Wilshire for being here, and Joan, you had a great guest today.
She was fantastic. Kristin White, the Executive Director of the Connected and Automated Vehicle Division of the Minnesota Department of Transportation, otherwise known as Autonomous Vehicles. So they'll be coming down a road near you soon.
Yeah, and you'll have a big audience here in the disability community because we're all excited about it. Also, before we go, we want to mention the passing of Cliff Potts. And he's an advocate for the disabled community that has spent a lot of time and tireless hours down at the state capitol, state office building, and the Senate, fighting for the rights and the betterment of the disabled community. Again, our condolences to Cliff Potts, for Joan Wilshire and the entire team here at SBNN. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints.